like to think back to 1904 and my little four-room schoolhouse in Daytona Beach, Florida.
What began as a school for young black girls at the turn of the 20th century.
This was the inspiration that made me realize it could be done.
Laid the path for a groundbreaking leader to rise and help change our country. Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune. Now, Florida is penning a new page in the history books, one that sees the spotlight turn to this Central Florida gem, long overdue her moment to shine.
You should be proud. This is a moment for Florida.
Tonight, you will learn her captivating story and how she earned the honor of being named one of the greatest Floridians.
I have always been a dreamer. Every one of these projects started as a dream.
Turning dreams into a masterpiece while carving a path for future generations.
I'm just proud. Proud to say that I'm a legacy of her work.
It was necessary to make others see that these dreams can come true.
This is WESH2 Chronicle, the life and legacy of Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune.
We are standing at the feet of history. This is the marble likeness of Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune.
Educator, civil rights leader, women's rights icon, a trailblazer for equality.
Now, if Dr. Bethune's name and story are not familiar to you, that is about to change because she is now adding to her list of distinctions. First African-American to represent a state in Statuary Hall at the U.S. Capitol.
4 years ago, Florida lawmakers decided to replace one of the two statues currently in Congress, a Confederate general, with the woman who, born to former slaves, will go on to change our state, the nation, and the world.
Tonight, we're digging into the process that declared Dr. Bethune one of Florida's greatest citizens.
We are going to show you how this work of art came to be and follow its journey to the statue's permanent home in Washington, D.C.
To understand why Dr. Bethune was bestowed this incredible honor, you really have to understand where she came from, all she overcame, and all she accomplished.
We have helped to build America with our labor.
Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune.
I like to swagger a cane, and the president knew it.
Renowned speaker, civil rights activist, educator, and advisor to multiple presidents.
I leave you love. I leave you hope. I leave you a thirst for education.
But to say this highly accomplished woman came from humble beginnings would be quite the understatement. Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune was born on a cotton farm near Maysville, South Carolina in 1875 to former slaves, the 15th of 17 children, the only one to attend school. Her passion for learning started early, and even while helping pick cotton on her family's farm, Mary would still go to school, first in her town, then eventually as far away as Chicago, where she graduated seminary school. And if she had had her way, Mary would have then become a missionary. Bethune historian Dr. Elaine Smith.
She wanted to go to Africa because she had heard of the desperate need. She applied to the Presbyterian board, and they said they had no openings for a black missionary. Just think of it. No openings in Africa for a black missionary on a black continent. She said it was the cruelest disappointment of her life.
So Bethune refocused and poured her energy into education. She became a teacher and eventually met fellow teacher and minister Albertus Bethune, who would later become her husband. Together, they would educate black children in South Carolina and Georgia before moving to Florida just before the turn of the 20th century. Settling first in Palatka, Mary McLeod Bethune taught for 5 years at two schools before setting her sights on Daytona Beach. There, Dr. Bethune's dream was to start a school of her own for young African-American women. Years later, she spoke about it on an episode of radio show This Is Your Life, recorded in 1949.
I had $1.50 in cash, but I had faith in God. I believed in my people, and I had confidence in Mary McLeod Bethune.
So, in 1904, with just $1.50, Dr. Bethune opened the Daytona Industrial and Educational Institute with five students and her son, Albert. Dr. Bethune and the students sold food and baked goods to supplement the school's finances. They also did outreach to organizations within the community, courting wealthy whites for not only donations, but to sit on the school's board of directors, a key move by Bethune that would put her in contact with influential people across the U.S. But education wasn't her only passion. So was activism.
Democracy is for me and for 12 million black Americans a goal toward which our nation is marching. It is a dream and an idea in whose ultimate realization we have a deep and abiding faith.
Dr. Bethune would go on to found as well as head several influential civil rights organizations, including the National Council of Negro Women and the National Association of Colored Women. She also served as vice president of the NAACP. And always focused on children, Bethune lobbied for black youth, co-founding the United Negro College Fund, which to this day provides scholarships for black students, as well as scholarships for the nation's historically black colleges and universities. Dr. Bethune also understood the power of the vote. She was a suffrage movement member working to first help white women secure the vote.
When women got the vote in 1920, she had a class. She had a class to educate women on how you vote, what is involved in the process, and she led a delegation down to the polls.
When Jim Crow laws in the South created obstacles for black men to vote, Dr. Bethune's school provided tutoring for voter registration literacy tests, fundraised to help pay poll taxes, and held voter registration drives.
As we have been extended a measure of democracy, we have brought to the nation rich gifts. We have helped to build America with our labor, strengthened it with our faith, and enriched it with our song. But even these are only the first fruits of a rich harvest, which will be reaped when new and wider fields are opened to us.
Dr. Bethune's work would also take her to the White House. After developing a friendship with First Lady Eleanor Roosevelt, Dr. Bethune went on to influence FDR's presidential administration, even forming the Federal Council on Negro Affairs, a coalition of the leaders of prominent black organizations who would then go on to advise the president. Dubbed the Black Cabinet, they lobbied FDR on issues specifically facing black people in America. In all, Dr. Bethune would advise five presidents. She enjoyed a long friendship with Eleanor Roosevelt, the two considering each other peers. Their relationship, an example of the type of racial harmony Dr. Bethune worked toward her whole life. This is Eleanor Roosevelt speaking of her friend in 1955.
I have come to admire and respect you and to love you for the spirit that goes in to all your work for all people.
Mrs. Bethune is off to the San Francisco conference as a special consultant.
You can understand now why Dr. Bethune's work and influence would take her across the globe. One of her trips to Europe led to an encounter with what would become one of the most iconic symbols of her legacy, the Black Rose. Bethune historian Dr. Sheila Fleming.
She saw this very dark, what looked like a black rose. And she began to think about God's diversity and how important it is for all of us to get along like a garden, in terms of humanity being a garden and God making different people looking different, although they are the same. They are rose, but they have different colors. She came back to Bethune-Cookman and started calling her students Black Roses.
It's a term of affection still used to this day, and the name of a society that works in service of Dr. Bethune's mission of serving children. Her experiences and influence culminating in her invitation to the founding of the United Nations. Dr. Bethune, the only black woman present. Mary McLeod Bethune died in 1955. She was 79 years old. Her funeral was held on campus and she's buried on the grounds of Bethune-Cookman University. Bethune's final message, her last will and testament. It's become a cornerstone of her legacy. It reads, "I leave you to love. I leave you to hope. I leave you your faith. I leave you a thirst for education. I leave you racial dignity. I leave you a desire to live harmoniously with your fellow men. I leave you, finally, a responsibility to our young people.
Still to come.
This beautiful piece of marble I am so lucky to have from the cave of Michelangelo.
We're taking you to Italy for an exclusive look at the creation of Dr. Bethune's marble likeness. But first, more about Mary.
I don't know if you can find a single figure in the history of Daytona that runs through the whole city in the way in which she did.
From medicine to sports, and even oceanfront real estate, how she made her mark on Daytona Beach in ways you may have never heard of, when Chronicle continues.
Only on West 2.
And whose life do we search tonight, Johnny?
Tonight, this is your life, Mrs. Mary McLeod Bethune of Daytona Beach, Florida.
On March 15, 1949, Mary McLeod Bethune was the subject of the popular NBC radio program, This Is Your Life. Mrs. Bethune and friends from her past who'd helped her rise from the daughter of former slaves to an education and civil rights champion traveled to New York City to appear on the radio show.
Do you, Miss Edwards?
Some say I've heard it said Bethune, but you say Bethune. Do you mind if we look back through the 74 years of your life tonight?
I shall be happy to have you so do.
Oh, I'm glad you don't mind, because this is the story of a great dream and the people who helped to change it to reality. This is the story of Mary McLeod Bethune.
You can hear the full 24-minute program on the Chronicle page of WESH.com.
Welcome back to the life and legacy of Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune. Dr. Bethune's school, now a university, put her on the path to become both a national and international leader of her time, but her heart was always right here at Daytona Beach.
And Dr. Bethune's work in this community was groundbreaking, and in some cases, changed the course of history.
She was trying to be the conscience of the community.
Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune was a problem solver, and her efforts helped make everyday life better for African Americans in her adopted home of Daytona Beach and Volusia County. Now retired interim BCU president, Dr. Hiram Powell, walked us through some of Dr. Bethune's enduring local accomplishments.
Everywhere there was a need in the community that was not being met, she stepped in to meet that need.
At the turn of the 20th century in Florida, segregation kept ailing black men, women, and children out of hospitals. When one of Dr. Bethune's students at her girls' school was terribly sick from appendicitis, she was turned away by the local hospital. After being persuaded by Dr. Bethune, the young woman was treated on the back porch of the hospital. That indignation moved Bethune to found McLeod Hospital, where any person, regardless of color, could seek medical help. One of the old hospital buildings still stands on the corner of campus. Another place Dr. Bethune helped open to all, the beaches. While today we have Bethune Beach, it's a place Dr. Bethune once again made happen.
Bethune Beach came about because there was no place that colored people, it was the title at that time, could go. And so she was able to petition the city or county to be able to give them a place so that they wouldn't, and that was typical practice in those days, if we don't want you to come where we are, we will give you a place where you can go.
Dr. Bethune always found a way to create change, and sometimes that meant going toe-to-toe with danger. When Dr. Bethune was helping to educate and mobilize black men to vote, she placed herself in the crosshairs of the Ku Klux Klan. The Klan marched on Bethune's campus twice in the early 20s, and that final time, they were met by the school's matriarch in the quad with all campus lights turned on the Knight Riders.
Because normally, you know, there was an inherent fear of colored people for white people. And you know, they would run, they would hide, whatever was going on, they would disband it. Dr. Bethune didn't do that. She opened the door, she stood out, had the kids surrounding her, and she stood and faced them face to face. She didn't approach them or do anything to move towards them or threaten them, but she just had that look of, we won't be moved.
Fourth inning, no score, Brooklyn up, and Jackie Robinson pokes one into the left field.
Dr. Bethune's work and influence in Daytona Beach helped pave the way for something most would not connect her with, baseball. Her efforts to create inclusion made a moment in history possible, March 17, 1946, when Jackie Robinson broke the color barrier in Major League Baseball.
So she was a forerunner in helping to facilitate the challenges that, at that point again, that colored people were having as they struggled to advance themselves.
If you've ever wondered why it was Daytona Beach where Jackie Robinson played the iconic first game, sports writer Wendell Smith sums it up pretty well. This progressive little resort on the banks of the beautiful Halifax River is now known as Florida's most liberal and American city. The healthy racial atmosphere can be attributed to the excellent work done by the faithful and energetic Mary McLeod Bethune.
Now, Jackie Robinson came in when I was in ninth grade, and he spoke to us in an assembly meeting. And he talked about basically the same thing that Ms. Bethune talked about being prepared.
Harold Lucas Jr. was just a boy watching and learning in 1946 from Jackie, but also Mrs. Bethune, as he calls her.
And I almost looked at Ms. Bethune as my grandmother or my aunt. I spent many nights in her home because my daddy would be over there taking dictation or doing something or sending out letters to different donors and all. She was a tough person now. Don't think that because she spoke softly that she was not a negotiator.
Mr. Lucas's father was Dr. Bethune's Guy Friday, an assistant secretary and right-hand man. He spent countless nights in her house at what is now the center of Bethune-Cookman University's campus, listening and watching as Dr. Bethune found problems and solved them.
Her influence, despite what happened on campus, reached far beyond here on campus.
I don't know if you can find a single figure
wow.
in the history of Daytona that runs through the whole city in the way in which she did.
This has been a journey. And a very long journey, and many people have taken part in this journey to get us to where we are today.
Making sure Mary McLeod Bethune became Florida's choice for Statuary Hall. The details behind this grassroots campaign, waged from Daytona Beach to Tallahassee. That's next on Chronicle, the life and legacy of Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune.
Welcome back. As stunning as the statue of Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune is, this 3-ton sculpture also carries with it a heavy meaning and message.
Dr. Bethune, a black woman and civil rights leader, replaces in Statuary Hall the likeness of a Confederate general who's represented the state of Florida there since 1922. It is a seismic shift for a state that has wrestled with racial equity for more than a century.
Getting to this place with Dr. Bethune as the state's choice as the next great Floridian has been a pretty long journey. It's the culmination of a grassroots campaign fueled by determination and faith.
We are rising out of the darkness of slavery into the light of freedom.
It is a big deal. You're talking about a black woman who was the first in her family born free, replacing a Confederate general.
This dream, this idea, this aspiration, this is what American democracy means to me.
It's true. Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune's greatest posthumous honor comes with immense weight, replacing Confederate General Edmund Kirby Smith as one of Florida's two representatives in Statuary Hall. That honor set in motion by tragedy.
To say our thoughts and prayers are with them and their families and their community doesn't say enough to convey the heartache and the sadness and the anger that we feel.
The 2015 racially charged mass shooting inside a black church in Charleston, South Carolina.
I think that the Charleston shooting allowed America to realize that we have not come as far as we thought we had. And people started saying, hey, we've got to do something.
In the aftermath of the Charleston shooting in 2016, then Florida Governor Rick Scott signed legislation to replace General Smith in Statuary Hall.
It was an opportunity Dr. Bethune supporters and alum did not overlook.
And we knew that we had to start sending letters or doing something to have a massive campaign.
A grassroots effort sprung forth, and Daisy Grimes was a driving force behind it from day one.
We started this campaign with the students at Bethune-Cookman and faculty and staff and people in this community.
The BCU graduate and at one point the university's director of legacy remembers the first obstacle was convincing people it was even possible.
Nobody ever thought that the state of Florida would replace a Confederate general with a black woman. That was just a real issue.
First, the state held a public vote to narrow down the list of potential replacements.
Here are our initial selection results. Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune with 4 votes.
From there, the selection committee created a short list. Dr. Bethune, Marjorie Stoneman Douglas, an author, women's rights advocate, and environmentalist known for her work protecting the Everglades from development, and George Jenkins, the founder of Publix Grocery Stores. But after hundreds, maybe even thousands of conversations, phone calls, letters, and meetings, the advocacy for Dr. Bethune was swelling and now coming from inside the state legislature. 3 men led the charge, former Democratic State Senator Perry Thurston and Daytona Representatives Republican Tom Leake and then Democratic Representative Patrick Henry, a BCU alum.
We started banging on doors, knocking on doors, and talking to state reps. Even from some of the really strong conservatives, they liked the idea once I presented all the things that she had done.
And bipartisan support was a must with a Republican-controlled legislature.
She's the embodiment of bipartisanship, and it seemed like something that everyone should be able to get behind.
Republican Representative Tom Leake, working alongside Henry, first helped sway the members.
Was it hard to convince others in your party, the speaker, for example, was it hard to convince them?
No, really the issue is not, it wasn't difficult to convince anybody. It was the more difficult issue was making it a priority. We get 60 days to move things forward, and so only the high priority issues really get to move forward. And what this needed was someone to come and push it and say, no, this is a high priority. And as soon as I sat down with the speaker at the time, he said, you're right, that is a high priority, and that's an opportunity that we should take.
I only ask that when it's time to vote, that you vote yes. And join me in making history by putting Mary McLeod Bethune in the statutory hall.
And with that, Leake and Henry got it done.
111 yeas, 1 nays, Mr. Speaker.
Show the bill passes. Congratulations, Representative Henry.
And who was the one?
The one was Jay Fant. Never forget that name. He was a state rep out of Jacksonville. He told me he just didn't think that was right to replace Confederate generals.
Now it just had to pass the Senate. Which it did, unanimously, thanks in large part to then-State Senator Perry Thurston, who sponsored the Senate bill.
The truth be told, we vote unanimously on a lot of legislation, but not on controversial legislation. And this had the capability of being controversial, but it wasn't. And it wasn't because the people in the places who had the opportunity to speak on behalf of making this change did.
Even though the votes were in and counted, Dr. Bethune's statue wasn't yet a done deal. Here's why. To widen the appeal of their candidate during the selection process, the backers of Marjorie Stoneman Douglas and George Jenkins offered to pay for the statue's creation, taking the cost burden off of the state of Florida. So, to keep her in the running, Dr. Bethune's supporters did the same.
You know, you've got some great people who put together the financing subsequent that made it happen.
Helping lead that effort, the Mary McLeod Bethune Statuary Fund chairperson, Nancy Lohman.
In my opinion, it's kind of a bigger mission than that, just raising money. You know, I want to raise the awareness and make sure the whole world appreciates who Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune is.
Under Lohman's leadership, the Statuary Fund raised more than $700,000 to pay for the marble statue, a bronze replica, which will stand in Daytona Beach, and the creation of a K-12 curriculum about Dr. Bethune for public schools.
I think there's a tremendous sense of pride in our community that Mary McLeod Bethune, this trailblazer, this community activist, this woman who did things that were remarkable. And I just hope and will try my best to make sure that the entire community embraces her as the hero that she is.
Next, we are taking you to the Italian Alps.
Now I feel that she's so deserving, and
that it's such an honor for me to do a personal, you know, a giant of a person.
See where and how the 11-foot, 6,000-pound, one-of-a-kind statue was created when Chronicle continues.
You have interpreted my dream.
A new day is dawned for the legacy of Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune. Once nicknamed the First Lady of the Struggle, Dr. Bethune's life dedicated to helping African Americans achieve better access to education and equality has borne tremendous fruit. And now she stands at the gateway of democracy in Washington, D.C. We continue our look at how this memorial to Dr. Bethune, a glorious statue carved of the world's best marble, came to be. Here again are Stuart Moore and Summer Knowles.
After being selected as the symbol of Florida to stand in the U.S. Capitol, work immediately started to create a masterpiece that was fitting of this dynamic, trailblazing leader.
It will require a sculptor with the same heart and passion as Dr. Bethune to capture her essence and create a work of art that rivals the greats.
As it turns out, this artist is just as unique as the subject, a woman, also a minority, working in a male-dominated field.
Sheldon Dutez introduces the master sculptor responsible for Dr. Bethune and shows us how this towering symbol came to be.
You see the campanile, which was designed by Michelangelo.
Thousands of miles from Florida, across the Atlantic.
To be here is like a dream for most sculptors, to be able to come to Pietra Santa from all over the world.
In Pietra Santa, Italy. Is where Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune was reborn. At the hands of master sculptor Nilda Comas.
I feel that she's so deserving and that it's such an honor for me. It's been a really wonderful experience.
Nilda is the artist the state of Florida chose to create Dr. Bethune's statuary hall likeness. The West Palm Beach resident beat out 9 others, all men, for the honor. It was her specialty, working with marble, that landed her the coveted role. All of the others wanted to cast Dr. Bethune in bronze, not Nilda.
It's like the biggest honor in history that you can give a person is to do a sculpture in marble.
Which brings us back to Pietra Santa. Nestled in Tuscany, Pietra Santa is where the world's best marble sculptors work, like Michelangelo.
You see that area that is sort of yellowish, zigzag back there? That is the area of Statuario. I believe this is where the David came from.
It's also where the world's best marble is found, in the caves of the Appian Alps.
We're very, very lucky that such a piece, because this type of marble is what all sculptors look for.
Getting to this final version of the monument of Dr. Bethune took years of preparation before Nilda could even begin to envision her creation.
I always like to know the person.
She needed a sense of who Dr. Bethune was. Nilda began with Bethune's relatives and her early life in South Carolina.
I was invited by her niece to come up to Maysville. And so I went to where she was born. She took me to the log cabin and to the church where she used to go.
Nilda then spent time at Bethune-Cookman. She also entered Dr. Bethune's home and had rare access to BCU's Bethune Library Archive, which is off limits to most. But she also wanted to make sure that this statue captured Dr. Bethune's essence.
I have always been a dreamer. Every one of these projects started as a dream.
When I heard her voice, I was just like, it was very emotional for me to hear her voice.
It was necessary to make others see that these dreams can come true.
She's very soft-spoken, but very direct in what she was saying.
My daughters, those of you who are scattered over America and other parts of the world, I've been the dreamer. But oh, how wonderfully you have interpreted my dreams. You are interpreters.
Dr. Bethune's audio recordings from interviews and speeches like these helped Nilda determine the statue's expression and posture.
A slight smile of like kindness, but satisfaction of what she's done. And that's why I decided I would do her at an age where she had already been in Washington, D.C.
Armed with the sound of her voice, photographs that spanned her life, and experiencing her surroundings, Nilda began to create. She started with a 12-inch model.
I brought this first model, which I made in Fort Lauderdale in my studio there in Florida, using plastiline.
Eventually, Nilda moved her work to her studio in Pietrasanta, where she carefully collected the last large slab of statuary marble mined from the caves Michelangelo used for his famous works. Honed for months in Pietrasanta, every detail of Dr. Bethune's likeness has meaning. She is wearing a stately cap and gown symbolizing her lifelong commitment to education. Dr. Bethune is also holding a walking stick carved in the likeness of the one given to her from President Roosevelt's collection. And Dr. Bethune's other hand is a black rose. The unique flower became an important symbol to Bethune after discovering it during her travels to Europe. And supporting Mary McLeod Bethune as she stands tall on her pedestal is a stack of books, a symbol of her love of learning. Each one is inscribed with a tenet from her last will and testament.
It is challenging because it's very physical. We have to constantly be moving the scaffolding, and you know, your hands get tired, your eyes get tired, you get dust in your eyes. But it is also very rewarding because as you work, you see what you've done.
And what she did is create a masterpiece.
I wanted her to look strong because she was a strong woman, but I also wanted her to be kind because she was a kind woman. So I wanted to show it in her eyes.
When people see this statue, what do you want them to take away from it?
I want them to understand humankind, that we are all kind, should be kind to each other, like she thought.
Nilda Comas, the first Hispanic woman to sculpt a female figure for Statuary Hall, told me this work will stay with her for the rest of her life.
What is the one thing about her that you're going to take away from your research and your experience throughout all of this?
Perseverance. She was determined and she had a lot of perseverance.
After Nilda completed her work, the statue received a customary blessing and send-off from Italy. Present for that event, members of the statuary committee, as well as Bethune-Cookman University's leadership and students. The masterpiece was then crated and shipped to its next destination, Daytona Beach.
When we come back, how the hometown crowd celebrated Dr. Bethune's return and what it was like to be there.
I can't even put it into words. It's more of a feeling.
How the moment moved the crowds who paid homage to a woman they call their hero.
A warm welcome home for Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune as her statue was paraded through Daytona Beach on its way to going on display here in Central Florida. A police escort brought the marble masterpiece right down Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune Boulevard and through the campus of VCU. Its final destination right here at the Daytona Beach News Journal Center.
As soon as that big rig pulled in, the process of unloading the precious cargo began. Now, it took crews 10 hours to unload, uncrate, place and perfect Dr. Bethune's stunning likeness, at one point even repositioning it based on feedback from master sculptor Nilda Comas. And then the moment 3.5 years in the making, the unveiling of Mother Mary. Now for 2 months, Dr. Bethune's tribute stood right here in Daytona Beach for the public to marvel at.
And thousands did, making the trip from across Florida and some across the country to bask in history. Michelle Imperato found out what the experience meant to them.
I just got emotional, especially looking in her eyes and I could see her strength and her kindness.
I can't even put it into words. It's more of a feeling.
My first thought was I was blown away.
Only something truly special, someone truly special, can elicit such emotion. And she was a trailblazer, civil rights pioneer, a champion for education for all Black people. Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune was so much to so many.
She's like my legacy. My entire family went to Bethune-Cookman University.
I'm living proof of what she's speaking, of what she taught. So I'm just excited to be here.
Oh my God, I mean, she's peering into your soul and you're standing there saying, I feel as though I've done well.
We should take a picture.
Admirers from near and far came to the Daytona Beach News Journal Center to see up close the marble statue in Dr. Bethune's likeness, made to stand tall and represent Florida in Statuary Hall in Washington, D.C.
It's big, and it's someone who looks like me as a Black woman.
The significance of this moment in time, of a Black woman, the first to be chosen to represent a state, isn't lost on those who took in the exhibit. A powerful statement that Dr. Bethune's tireless work made a lasting impact and that her legacy lives on.
It's not only for Black people, but for white people to understand the struggle. And I think part of the problems that we have today is because of the lack of knowledge and also the lack of empathy for what people have gone through.
It keeps it alive. It keeps it alive. Even the work that she did back then and the fact that it's still so relevant today. And that's right, it's a negative and a positive, because you would think we would be so much further along today, so many years later. But the positive of it is that it makes us remember that the journey continues. The message continues. There's still a lot of work to be done.
And because the fight against racial injustice does continue today,
I put that she was the first African-American woman to represent the state.
A new generation in Volusia County is now learning about Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune more than ever before.
I think it's really an honor to be able to see this before it goes up to D.C.
Students throughout the district took part in interactive field trips to Dr. Bethune's exhibit.
The pair would educate Black children in South Carolina and Georgia before moving to Florida.
Most of them initially only knew of her name, but after reading the literature, hearing the story of her life, and seeing her towering statue, they walked away with a better understanding of Dr. Bethune's influence.
I definitely feel like very inspired. It just shows like anybody can do something. When she was super little, she was inspired to be educated, and now she helped educate many different people.
Very, very cool, very interesting, just to see everything, and especially the heart and her neck.
The marble statue was only in Daytona Beach for a few months, but it sparked meaningful conversations about equality and representation.
She's the first African-American woman to go there, and it made me really happy, because the more representation that we get, the more we can get in life without being discriminated against.
What the students learned here will last. Volusia County is working with the state of Florida to create a new curriculum about Dr. Bethune for all Florida students.
We have plans to develop an elementary, middle, and high school curriculum based around Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune and the statue project. And that way, it'll be available to our students at all three grade levels so that they really do have a greater understanding of the impact that she had.
A fitting and possibly overdue tribute to a woman who started her lifetime of work through education. It's been said Dr. Bethune hasn't been given her proper place in history. Now, nearly 70 years after her death, her statue is seen as unifying and historic. A tribute to begin to finally give her the recognition she deserves.
I just think it will inspire all young girls, everyone who sees it. I'm just so proud, so happy.
She's amazing. She's amazing, still affecting people to this day.
I stood under the statue and I looked
in her eyes, and she was looking directly at me. And I was hoping that she was saying, well done, because you want her to be proud of us.
May I thank you, my friends. This is a very moving moment for me.
Next, a moment years, but truly decades in the making. Come along on the final leg of this incredible journey as Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune ascends to her place of honor in the U.S. Capitol, when Chronicle continues.
More than 15,000 people visited the Dr. Bethune statue while it was on display in Daytona Beach. After its residency at the News Journal Center, the marble masterpiece was meticulously recreated and prepared for the journey to its permanent home, Statuary Hall at the U.S. Capitol. And Stewart has made his way there as well. He joins us now from Washington, D.C. Hey, Stu.
Summer, I am just outside the U.S. Capitol where Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune's gorgeous marble replica now resides. It's been more than 6 months since Dr. Bethune's statue was on display in Daytona Beach. We just saw how the statue was carefully packed up from that exhibit to be moved here to D.C. But on the way here to the nation's capital, Dr. Bethune took a small detour. The semi-truck carrying Dr. Bethune's statue from Daytona Beach to Washington, D.C. made a special stop along the way, Maysville, South Carolina, Dr. Bethune's birthplace. Crowds there were able to catch a quick glimpse of her marble likeness before getting back on the road to Washington. And now, here we are, the culmination of so many years of perseverance, made possible through the sheer determination of so many people, people determined to see Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune take her rightful place in American history.
Today is the beginning of the celebration. You get a pom-pom to celebrate.
It's the weekend before Dr. Bethune's statue installation in Washington, D.C., and a good crowd has gathered at Lincoln Park. It's where Mother Mary's first national tribute stands. Everyone is in a celebratory mood. The Statuary Hall installation is just 3 days away, but
happy birthday to you.
It's also Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune's 147th birthday. Each year, there's a celebration of her birthday here, but this year, no one can deny it's especially sweet.
My heart is just filled with pride right now.
Crystal Lighty is a Daytona native and BCU grad who now lives in Maryland. She's part of the alumni group that puts on the annual gathering. She came home to Daytona Beach last fall to see the statue.
I am just proud to be a part of that legacy, hoping that this helps to continue her acknowledgement on a national level.
Hey. We're so glad that you're able to be with us today. We're going to board the buses.
The next day, the celebration of Dr. Bethune continued with a very special trip around the nation's capital.
I never had a chance to really experience Dr. Bethune's life in Washington, D.C., and so when I heard that they were going to do a bus tour, I had to get on it. I wanted to make sure we had a full scope of who she was, not just in Daytona Beach, Florida, but also in our nation's capital.
Led by the National Park Service, alum and admirers of Dr. Bethune boarded buses to see spots connected to and by Bethune.
Our first stop will be Asbury United Methodist Church.
Each location provided more insight into this groundbreaking and forward-thinking leader's life.
Now, she comes to Washington, D.C. in 1935, which is actually the same year she starts the National Council of Negro Women.
The Park Service maintains the Mary McLeod Bethune Council House. It's where Dr. Bethune lived during her time in the nation's capital and is now a National Historic Site. Every location had meaning to the work Dr. Bethune undertook.
Director of the Division of Negro Affairs of the National Youth Administration, the first black woman to head a federal agency.
Wow, that's awesome.
As inspiring as this tour is, the purpose of the pilgrimage is almost at hand. At the nation's capital, work is underway to give Mary McLeod Bethune a new home in D.C. First crews with cranes, then dollies through doorways. The unassuming wooden crate rolled through the rotunda would take more than 10 hours to unload. Precious cargo, priceless art, purpose beyond measure. the meticulous process leading up to the moment Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune and the state of Florida make history.
It is my privilege to welcome you to Statuary Hall as we celebrate a pioneering and patriotic American, the pride of Florida and America, Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune.
Well, I am proud to be a Floridian this morning because the people of the state of Florida have sent the great educator and civil rights leader, Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune, to represent our dynamic and diverse state.
During a 1948 event with the National Council of Negro Women, Dr. Bethune said, "In my final years of my life, I dare to work for the dream of a memorial for all women, because the time has come for it, and it is worth a cause worth sacrificing for." Well, that time has come. That time is now. That day is today.
The KKK, after the school was up and running, came marching on the small girl's school with torches, with robes, on horseback, and she stood alone at the gate and stared them down and stood them down. Madam Speaker, in my military career, I've seen some tough cookies, some tough women. I guarantee you this is the toughest one in the hall today.
And I remember as a little girl listening to my mother and my father talk about a black woman, a woman who looked like us, who started a college. As I listened to my parents tell the story, it seemed impossible. But Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune made what seemed impossible, possible.
Dr. Bethune takes her rightful place here as we honor a legendary American. In doing so, we ensure that young people, all young people, but especially young black women, girls, come to this Capitol and they see a reflection of our nation's beautiful diversity, beautiful success, and greater possibilities for them in their future. It is a glorious day in the capital of the United States. Thank you all for making it so. Thank you.
Seeing Dr. Bethune's statue here in its permanent home is truly a sight to behold. This honor now elevates her place in history, with Dr. Bethune's story hopefully inspiring new generations in her likeness. It has been our great privilege to document Dr. Bethune's life and the work of so many people to honor Dr. Bethune in such a significant way. For Summer and the entire Chronicle team, thank you for watching.